You end all your excuses for not doing the job, not doing the work, not obeying God. There's no end to your excuses. Of making many books, there is no end. And much study is a weariness of the flesh. You know, you say, I'm going to study Buddhism, I'm going to study Taoism, I'm going to study Judaism, I'm going to study Islamism, and I will come to a conclusion. He says, you'll get tired. He says, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. He says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter in a nutshell. Let's get the message. He says, fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. That's all. Fear God and keep his commandments. That is salvation. Jesus Christ told you the same. He says, verily, verily, I say unto you, most certainly I'm telling you this, except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. There's no heaven for you unless you are better than the Jew. Except it exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. He said again, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am come not to destroy but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, most certainly I am telling you, heaven and earth shall pass away, but one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law. Tittle, jot. Jot is the smallest letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Not even that amount is to go out of the law of God. So one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, or shall teach men so, shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall teach and do shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. I say, we teach and we do. I ask you, do you keep the laws and the commandments? You say, no. I say, why not? He says, the law is nailed to the cross. Why not? He says, we are living under grace. That's what the Christian says. You're living under grace. I say, where did you get this idea that the law is nailed to the cross, is done away with? Where did you get it? So he quotes me, Philippians, Galatians, Corinthians, Thessalonians, Colossians. And so who's this? Timothy, Romans, who's all this? What's this? Who is that? It's a Paul. I said, who's your master? You say, Jesus. What does he say? You're contradicting Jesus. And Jesus said, the disciple is not greater than the master. Master is Jesus. What he tells you, I say, I listen to my master, Jesus. He never ate the pig. None of his disciples ever touched that pork. You call it pork, ham, bacon, whatever you call it. He never touched that stuff. None of his disciples ever touched it. And you are all pig eaters. Christians. Where did you get this? He said, Peter had a dream. On that dream, now you eat pigs. When my master never ate it, he wouldn't eat it. It was abhorrent to him. He killed 2,000 pigs. One hit. He destroyed them all. You know that? But now you don't listen to him. You are now living under grace. I said, are you circumcised? He says, no. I said, why aren't you? It's a major commandment God gave. Your Lord was Christ, Jesus Christ, was circumcised. I said, what is good for your God should be good for you. No, you won't circumcise. Why won't you? This is the law of God. It entered into between Abraham and his descendants forever. And you claim to be spiritual descendants. How does that absolve you? It is Jesus was circumcised and you are not. He said, no. He says, Paul said, circumcision is nothing and non-circumcision is nothing. I said, Jesus says, not even one jot or one tittle is to pass from the law. Can't you see? You are not following Jesus. You're following Paul. He is the real founder of Christianity. Paul, not Jesus. Therefore, your great countryman, Michael H. Hart, he wrote a book on the top 100, the greatest 100 in history, the most influential 100 people from Adam to current time. And he gives us a list. The top 100 are the greatest 100 in history. Michael H. Hart, New York, of the Hart Publishing Company. And in that list of the most influential men, after giving the list of 100 names, he puts them in the order of seniority. Number one, number five, number 50, number 99. Who? And he puts Muhammad number one. The most influential man in history, according to Michael H. Hart, an American, in America, publishing a book of 572 pages, retailing about 10 years ago for $15, which I paid for it. Maybe it costs 50 today, I don't know. He says, Muhammad is the most influential man in history. And his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, number three. His God and Savior, number three. And he gives reasons. Not because some Arab bribed him. So here's 10,000 for you. Say a good word about Muhammad. Put him number one. You give 100,000, put him number one in your book. No, no Arabs could ever think of that. It's possible but not probable for an Arab to do that. Why does he put Jesus Christ as God and Savior number three? He said, you see, the honor for Christianity is to be shared between Paul and Jesus. Actually, Paul is the real founder of Christianity. This is it. So follow Jesus, listen to him, you can't help being a Muslim. You'll be a Muslim through and through. But you don't want to listen to Jesus. Read the books. Listen to the sermons. It's Paul, 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 not Jesus. What did Jesus say? He says, he is not of me who does not take his cross and follow me. Take up your cross and follow me. But the cowards that we are not prepared to pick up the cross.
I understand from other teachings that I've heard about Islam that most of the Islam people would agree with certain things in the Bible. They would agree with what is in the Quran. Is that correct? Okay. In the Christian teaching, it says that Jesus, according to the Gospels, as you've already talked about, did in fact die on the cross and was the payment for all of our sins, which through him is the way for us to be able to have his righteousness and therefore be perfect in God's sight. I was curious as to the view in the Quran as to the crucifixion, if indeed it did or did not happen.
Thank you. With regards to the crucifixion, the Quran is very explicit. Very explicit. It says, وَقَوْلِهِمْ إِنَّا قَتَلْنَا الْمَسِيحَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, that they said in boast that we killed Christ Jesus, the son of Mary, the apostle of God. In answer to that, God says, وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ, that they didn't kill him and they didn't crucify him. وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ, but it was made to appear to them so. وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ اخْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ لَفِي شَقٍّ مِّنْهُمْ, and those who dispute therein are full of doubts. مَا لَهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ عِلْمٍ, they have no certain knowledge. إِلَّا اتِّبَعَ الظَّنَّ, they only follow conjecture, guesswork. وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ يَقِينًا, for a surety they killed him not. That's the Muslim position. We say, آمَنَّا صَدَّقْنَا, we hear and we affirm. But now, my sister says, look, we have a record. The Christian says we have a written record. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, these 27 books of the New Testament. And we have hundreds of prophecies fulfilling this event. My response is, I said, look, my brothers and sisters, you are reading this book, the Bible, in your own mother tongue. And I'm claiming that you are understanding the exact opposite of what you're reading. Not just misunderstanding. We can have a lot of misunderstanding, but exact opposite. If you read in the Bible, for example, that thou shalt not commit adultery, you are understanding that thou shalt commit adultery. So how can we be such zombies? What do you take us for? You know, we are the people who live on the moon. You know, we got the whole world in the palm of our hand. You have. The Bay of Bengal tragedy. See, America warned Pakistan. They said, look, the tidal waves are coming. Be on guard. They didn't heed the warning, the fools, my people. They didn't heed the warning. And hundreds of thousands more people died. They warned the Jews in 1973 that the Arabs are on the move. They didn't heed the warning. So we know the Arabs. Every time they want to do anything, they make a big noise beforehand. So when we will do this and we will do that, and by then they said, we'll give it to them. So they didn't heed the warning. First time the Arabs caught the Jews off guard. They broke the Barlev line. First time they took the initiative because they didn't heed the American warning. You got the whole world in the palm of your hand. And yet this same nation, he's reading the book in his own mother tongue and is understanding the exact opposite of what you're reading. This is not just a charge, an allegation. I prove it to you in 2 minutes. I said, you know, Jesus returned to that upper room after his alleged crucifixion, where they had the Last Supper. Those of you who know your Bible, you know what I'm talking about. He goes in and he wishes his disciples in the Hebrew language, Shalom Aleichum, which means same as Salam Aleikum in Arabic, peace be unto you. And when he said, peace be unto you, his disciples were terrified. So I'm asking, why were they terrified? Because when you meet your long-lost master, your uncle, your grandfather, the Arab and the Jew, we embrace one another, we kiss one another. I felt very funny the first time the Arabs did it to me. But I'm getting used to it now. You see, I said, that's what the Jews did 2,000 years ago, and the Arabs did 2,000 years ago. Instead of doing that, they're terrified. I said, why were they terrified? So the man knows his Bible. He said, look, Luke chapter 24, verse 36, he tells us that they were affrighted because they thought he was a spirit. Is that the answer? Yes, that's what the Bible says. Luke says, they thought he was a spirit. So I said, did he look like a spirit? And by now, for 40 years I'm talking, not one Christian has ever told me yes. If he did, if you do, I said, what does a spirit look like? If he said he looked like a spirit, I said, what does a spirit look like? Tell me now. No, everybody says no, he didn't. So I said, why should they think the man is a spirit when he didn't look like one? Puzzled. So I said, you see, the reason is that the disciples of Jesus, they had heard from hearsay people talking that the master was hanged on the cross. They had heard from hearsay people were talking that he had given up the ghost. You know, the spirit had come out, he had died. They had heard from hearsay that now he's dead and buried for 3 days. All the knowledge was from hearsay people talking, because they were not eyewitnesses or your witnesses to the happening. Because Mark chapter 14 verse 50, he tells us that at the most critical juncture in the life of Jesus, all his disciples forsook him and fled. All. I said, does all mean all in your language, you Englishman? He said, yes, that they were not there. All the knowledge was from hearsay. On hearsay knowledge, if you heard about a man, your master, who's dead and buried for 3 days, you expect him to be stinking in his grave. Such a person, when you see, naturally you're terrified. You think he's a ghost, a spook, spirit. So Jesus wants to assure them that they're not what they're thinking. So he says, Unzuru ila yadayya wa rijalayya. He says, behold my hands and my feet. Inni ana huwa, that it is I myself. Husuni wanzuru. He says, handle me and see. Fa inna ruha laysa lahu lahmun wa zamun. For a spirit has no flesh and bones, as you see me have. Handle me and see. A spirit has no flesh and bones. A spirit means any spirit.